is either you're early. How many got here late for the 9 o'clock and you're actually early for the 11 o'clock? No. Some of you were just right on time. Some of you were posting during worship because I was liking your posts. Just saying. Hey, we're glad you guys are here. And I love the fact that this week there was a bluebird, a redbird, and a robin all in the same tree together. How many know there's got to be a God when all those guys show up together in the same same tree? So, but spring's definitely here. I've been watching geese go north and south. I think they're a little confused which way they should be going right now, but they've been flying over my house, both north and south. Man, we're just really, really glad you guys are here. I got some really good news for you. Travis, you'll probably like to hear this one, but this, Cindy, this is true. This is true. I heard this. Women that carry a little extra weight actually live longer than men who notice it. Oh, that's funny. I don't care who you are. That is like, oh, yeah. So be careful what you notice. But, man, we've been in a series. We started last week. It's called Brand New, and it literally is talking about the fact that we're no longer like sinners saved by grace. So like we were that. And we found out that we're actually not even human anymore, but we're a brand new creation. How many would say about their husbands, I know he's not human? Okay, so, yep, we got one. I see that he's not here with you today, Mrs. Bucciarelli. That's good that you can say. He's probably watching live, though, so you'll have to deal with that when you get home. But if you want to look back at the other series, go to journey-center.com and you can see those. Accelerant happens this week, so if you would like to participate, we're stoked about that. All week long, we're going to be in here just getting ruckus, so it's going to be a good time. Starts Wednesday night, goes through Saturday night, and then Sunday we reconvene. And have all the big boys are still going to stay around and hang with us. Jake Hamilton's going to do worship for us next Sunday morning, so it's going to get stupid in here. So just want to make sure you invite anyone who would like to come along and dance and smile and or just sit there and watch other people dance and be stupid. It's always fun to watch. People's better than any TV. It's reality TV is what it is. So, but if you'd like to buy a ticket and attend, we'd love to have you. Buy a ticket for a friend. They would love to have it. Buy a ticket and serve. Really need a lot of people that would do that. We have hundreds of people coming in from the region, and we just like to really welcome them and serve them well as they come into our house, and then become a partner and invest in what Accelerant is, not only for this year, but for the future, because it is changing the atmosphere, not only here, but it's changing the atmosphere of our culture. So we just wanted to have you guys, invite you guys to that. Last week, we found out it's an ant. I'm just determining whether I want to kill it or not. Like, can you take care of it, Curtis? But just let him, release him outside. Okay. Look how cute he is. He just killed him. I could have done that, dude. No, I think he actually grabbed him. But last week we started talking about the temple model. And Jesus actually came. I can't say when I was standing or stand up. Jesus actually came to destroy the temple model. And every religion, every major religion in the world has a temple model. But if Jesus came to destroy it, why do we still have it? Yeah? Anybody want to destroy it with me? Two people, three people? Get out, man. The temple model said this. Let's create a whole bunch of sacred places where we can have sacred texts, where sacred men, and it was always men, it was never women, only men could be sacred in the temple model. And they would have sincere followers. But what we found was when Jesus came not to create a temple 2.0 or an improved temple model, but Jesus came to actually start something brand new. You see, he didn't want it to be any more about sacred places. He didn't want dirt to be more important than the people sitting next to you. somewhere along the way, we made church more important than the people who were in the church. Does anybody remember this? Let me just talk. I'm a preacher's kid, so I got a lot of this stuff growing up. But I remember the abuse that I took as a preacher's kid growing up. I remember if I had to go to the bathroom and I walked out the door, everybody would tell my dad about me walking out the door and going to the bathroom during the church service. How disrespectful that was to walk out of the church service and go to the bathroom. My dad, one Sunday, I was walking out, and he looked at me, and he goes, "I'll take care of that when we get home." He wanted everybody to know that he noticed, so they didn't come complaining to him that I walked out the door. We didn't have text messaging back then, so I left my dad a note so that when he came out of the service, I left it on his desk, and it said, "Dad, I'm really sorry, but I really had to go." He came home, and he laughed. But a realization came. And it began a long time ago in the church that we have majored on things that we shouldn't be majoring on. It happened a long time ago that the things that the world was finding resistible to the church, we have started discovering that we should resist it too. Let me give you for instance. I have never had a person say to me, "Scott, I don't like the way that you love God so much." I've never had anybody say that to me. I've never had anybody say to me, I don't like your passion for him or your passion for people. I've never had anybody ever say that to me. But you know what I have had people come to me and be resistant about the gospel of Jesus or about God himself is this. You know, I walked in and I didn't feel loved. I walked in and I didn't seem to fit. I walked in and nobody said hi to me. I walked in and I heard people talking about other people. I walked in and I felt judged when I walked in. I walked in and people looked at me because I was wearing a hat or I was wearing shorts or I had makeup on or I had earrings or maybe I looked down that day. I walked in and maybe I smelled a little bit bad. But at least I walked in. Can I just tell you something, man? We should be resisting the same things that the world is finding resistible about the church. And we should start embracing the things that the world says, "I just want to feel valuable. I just want to feel important. I just want to feel like it matters that I'm there. I just want to feel like I don't want a friendly church anymore, but I'd like to have some friends. I'd like to have some family. I don't want to feel isolated, alienated anymore. I want to become a part of something greater than myself." That's what I think the church is for. Does that make sense? Atmosphere is everything. You walk into a restaurant, you walk into any business, you walk in, the first thing you notice is what's the atmosphere like? And you and I have the ability, because of the atmosphere that sits right inside of us, we have the ability to change the atmosphere all around us. By a smile, by a touch, by a look, by a thought, by a conversation. Are people important or are places more important? Is the dirt you're standing on that we call holy ground more important than the holy ones that stand right next to you? That's where we went wrong, man. I don't know how many times I watch people come in and walk out of church doors, even in this place, because somebody made a remark, "Hey, you need to take your hat off. Oh, hey, smokers, you go over here." Now, listen, I think you ought to take your hat off. I think you shouldn't smoke, you should suck. Let the cigarette smoke. Do you see what I'm saying? It's like, why are we repelling people with a repellent that God never used, that Jesus never used? Why is it that everyone always felt so good around Jesus and they don't feel good around church people? Do you know what I'm saying? But can I say this about y'all? Y'all, that's my southern thing, y'all. Y'all are changing that. Y'all are being that. Y'all are making people feel loved, welcomed, encouraged. They feel like life. They feel I think they feel like they're hanging around with Jesus. And maybe that's what we're really supposed to be doing. No one ever had a problem in the world with Jesus. You know who had a problem with Jesus in the world? Were the religious folks. I think it's true today. So let's see if we can together, if we can change this thing and do something brand new. See, because Jesus came and said, I'm going to give you a new covenant. I'm going to give you a new contract. I'm going to give you something new that you don't have to bring anything old into the new. And he got crazy. He said, listen, I didn't come to like abolish the law, but I came to fulfill it. Can I just, everybody just do this with me real quick. I want you to put a check mark next to new covenant. Can you do that with me? Right in your, just do this. Check. Okay, done, job finished, completed. New chapter. Leave that there and bring, and hey, let's get on to the new thing now. Then he said this. Hey, you know all those 630 some commands that I had you memorize? You can forget them now. And just remember this one. And he gave us a new command that wasn't an adjective, it wasn't a noun, it was a verb, and it's called love. And he said, if you can just learn to love me, with all your heart, soul, and mind, and learn to love yourself, and learn to love each other, love your neighbor, love your enemies. Hey, everything of the law and everything of the prophets, it hangs on this. Listen, it's a good idea not to steal from somebody, but if you love somebody, you're not going to steal from them. It's a good idea not to murder somebody, but if you love somebody, you're not going to murder them. It's all right, actually, to like people. Now, I love you, but it's because I have to. I love my husband because I signed the contract. Like, come on, man. We get to be loved, and we get to love because we're so loved. Yes? I mean, it's just, you guys are really tired. You should have seen the 9 o'clock. It was really bad. But he gave us a new ethic. He said, listen, I know this is legal. But what's love demand? I know that you think it's okay and that there's minimum requirements, but hey, there's a new ethic. There's a new work ethic. There's a new heart. There's a new passion. There's a new purpose. There's a new reason to get up in the morning. There's a new way to do things. I'm going to give you a brand new ethic. So you don't have to do anything anymore. You get to. Way better way to live. And all that began when Jesus came and said, I'm not interested in a temple. I'm not interested in this place, but I am interested in a new movement. And I'm going to gather a bunch of people who are going to change the world. And he's still doing it today. You know why? Because genuine and authentic is what everyone is looking for. And he is genuine and he is authentic. And it's time for us to reveal him appropriately. And there's not a better way to reveal the Father than to actually love people the way that we were loved. But here's the problem. A lot of us in the temple model, we never learned how to love. We never were loved. We never embraced love. See, that's why we stay around here. We need to embrace his presence. His presence is full of love. God is love. It's not a part of his character. It's not a part of his nature. It's not like God is, his very essence is love. How can you say you love God and not love those around you? Ooh. Yeah, Pastor Scott, I got a problem with that. This guy is, you don't understand. He stinks. He smokes. Does drugs. Oh, here we go. I love this one. Okay, listen, if you're Catholic, don't leave. Because I'm going to talk about the Baptists, Presbyterians, the Methodists, and the Pentecostals all at the same time. It's going to be so fun. We all get to be offended today. It's so good. So here's the deal. Here's the deal. When I was growing up, I had friends that were Catholic. I had friends that were Baptist, Presbyterian, Methodist, atheist. I remember my Catholic friends would say, man, I got to go to confession. I go, confession? We got to go to confession. Just tell God you're sorry and get on with life. You don't need to go to confession. Oh, no, I got to go to confession. I got to go see the priest. I got to go sit there. I got to do some Hail Marys. I got to do this. And I got to do this. And then it's like, And I was like, man, you don't need to do that. You just need to go to God and just confess it and just get over. You don't need it. Yeah, you just do it. And then I found out, I said, dude, you know, you drink. He goes, you don't drink? Well, no, I don't drink. Well, why don't you drink? Well, you're not supposed to. Right? Then they go, well, we drink. I go, I know. He goes, and we drink in church. You do? We do. We, you know, Jesus turned water into wine. I go, Jesus didn't turn the water into wine. That was grape juice, man. Do you know why I believed it was grape juice? Because I was taught that way. Do you know it's a greater miracle to turn water into wine than it is grape juice? Because wine demands time. And I don't drink. I just wish I did. Just saying. But the temple model was built around a standard that guess who the only ones who could meet it were? The elite. The grand poobahs. The elite. And then those that had these standards, guess what they did? They would water them down to the point where they were the standards that they knew that they were meeting, so they would pray brilliantly in front of everyone when behind the scenes, their hearts were wicked. They put on the show. They make sure everybody knew that, you know, they were righteous because the way they prayed, because the way they tithed, because the way they went to the temple, because the way they held up to the standards, and they kept the standards that they knew that they could fulfill in front of the people because they wanted to require those that were following them to make peace with God by coming to the temple every single day. You better get right with God. You better get right with God. You better get right. And me as a Pentecostal, charismatic Christian, whatever I was, whatever I was raised and taught to be, I would make mistakes and I'd find myself at the altar every week. So I didn't have to go to the confession booth, but I had such guilt and condemnation on me, I literally got saved every weekend. I gotta go to the altar. I gotta go to the altar. I gotta go to the altar. I gotta repent. I gotta repent. I gotta cry. I gotta be broken. I gotta be ashamed. I gotta feel condemnation. I gotta feel guilty, all this kind of stuff, because I was taught that that's what a good Christian boy did. Can I just tell you something? Jesus came to bash that thing into the ground. Therefore is no longer, there's none, zero condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus. If you're feeling, listen, if you're feeling anything other than what he came to purchase for you, try another version of Christianity. Listen, stay with me. The old temple model was nation specific. You had to be a part of Israel to be a part of it. Or you had to be a part of a Muslim nation to be a part of it. Whatever sacred place there was, you had to belong to certain. Can I just tell you, Jesus came to break that all up and he says, listen, I want all people groups to come. You are welcome in my house. That makes sense? So he broke all of that stuff. Y'all are welcome. All y'all. See, but our consciences determine religious realities, whether they reflect reality or not. How have you been taught? You don't believe me about this? Watch this. Man, you shouldn't feel guilty about that. Honey, listen, you didn't mean that. You shouldn't feel bad about that. Talk to your kids. Hey, baby, you don't have to. Listen, you don't feel guilty. How does that work? Well, because our conscience has been trained a certain way, we've heard it said, or we've been in an environment that says, if you do this, then you better feel this way. Then what happens is our conscience brings condemnation on us that Holy Spirit isn't. Because I'm going to tell you something, when Holy Spirit comes on you, he convicts you, and when he convicts you, you feel better about it. You can always tell condemnation because condemnation makes you feel like crud. But conviction comes, oh, I get to be clean. I get to step away from that thing. Am I making sense? And see, so our consciences, what we do is, because this is a big deal. We've been taught this, and here's the deal. A mind that is not renewed is at enmity with God. You and I have to renew the way that we think, and we've got to think the way that Jesus thought, not the way that religion tells us or a political kingdom tells us. We got to think like the kingdom, and we got to think like sons and daughters of God, and we got to think about us being beloved and that he's for us, not against us. And when we get that thing, watch, when we get that thing, don't clap until about week 5 because you may not be here. The goodness of God is so hard for us to swallow because nobody's that good. The goodness of God is so hard for us to swallow because if he's going to love me that way, he must want something out of me. If he's going to be that kind to me, if he's going to be that good to me, there must be some wrong motivation for why he wants to be so nice to me. We can't handle unconditional love. We got to earn it some way. We got to work for it some way. We got to beat ourselves up some way. We got to be bad. We're a sinner. We got a sinful nature. Can I tell you something? You were sinners who were saved by grace, but now you are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. You are a brand new creation. All things have passed away. All things have become new. You live in a present future, not a past. That's just the truth, man. See, Pastor James said it is. And if we get this thing, it ruins us, it wrecks us, it thrills us, it changes us. If our lens gets the fact of, wow, God, you're that good. Wow. You love me that, what? What? You love me that much? What? How can you love me that much? It changes everything. When I know that my God is for me, when I know he's for me, when I really know he's for me, what can be against me? What thing can come against me if he's for me? What is so big that it's bigger than God? What problem can there be that's bigger than his resources? Huh? How am I doing, Matt? You staying with me, buddy? Okay, good. The Jews attempted to assimilate Jesus, his movement, into the temple model. They tried to take what Jesus was doing and say, oh, yeah, we like that, Jesus. Oh, yeah, that's a great idea. But we think, listen, everybody's got a little preference. Everybody's got a little thing going on. They got this little thing. Me and God got our thing. Everybody know that? Me and God, we got our thing. What is that? We got our thing going on. Listen, there ain't no thing going on with God that isn't going on in community. There ain't no individual thing. You're a part of a body. You don't have an individual thing going on. You're a part of a body. You're a part of a family. You know, Levi tries to have his individual thing in our house. But Levi's part of our family, so he doesn't have an individual thing in the house. Neither do you. You're a part of a body. You're called to be a part of a group of people. Don't be cut off. Don't be isolated. Don't be an island where the enemy can sniper you out. See what I'm saying? Makes good sense, right? Always wants to isolate us. So they attempted to assimilate these Jesus people into the Jewish model, the temple model. Can I tell you something? We're still trying to do that today. People come into the church and they go, well, let's see, what are we going to have to do to clean them up? Good to have them. This needs to go. Got to fix this. What? How about this? Let's start here. Let's love them unconditionally. And when, see, here's the deal. This is the deal the Holy Spirit made with us. He said, listen, you do your job, I'll do mine. Your job is to love the way that you've been loved. My job is to bring conviction. I can do my job when you're doing your job because you're representing God, I'm representing God. I am God. But see, a conduit happens into somebody's life where Holy Spirit can come and do, but see, here's the deal. If God judges, he judges perfectly. You and I don't. Pastor Scott, what do you think about this? I don't. What do you think about this? I don't. What do you think about this? I don't. What's your opinion about this? I don't have one except for his. And this is what Jesus said. I didn't come into the world to judge it. I came to save it. If Jesus didn't come into the world to judge it, I ain't doing it. Is everybody reading the same Bible I'm reading? He didn't come into the world to judge it. He came in to save it. How are we doing with that? When we see somebody, how do we see them? Do we see them as a finished work like he does? Or do we see them as a work in progress? How many have heard that story a million times? Oh, I'm just a work in progress. Stop making excuses. You aren't. You are a finished work because you're timeless, because you're eternal being. You're a finished work. He treats you like a finished work. So when you know that you're a finished work, then you can start acting like a finished work. I don't know. Me over here. I am in total shape. It's just not manifested yet. But I am, right? I got to have that. You got to have that mindset. How bad do you want it? First question we were asked, how bad do you want it? On a scale of 1 to 10, how bad do you want? I got to ask you this. How bad do you want to be this new creation that he's asked you to be? How bad do you want it? Because the whole world changes if we get this. Your work changes. Your family changes. Your health changes. Body, soul, and spirit. Your health changes. If you get this thing, it's a big, big deal. If we see like he sees. If we talk like he talks. If we hear like he hears. If we think like he thinks. And all of us can do that. Do you know that? All of us have that potential. Why? Because he lives inside of us. Do you know what lives inside of you? It's atomic. This little light. How many remember this song? This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, right? We're blowing it out the whole time. And the put it under a bushel. No, I'm gonna let it shine. Right? All that stuff, right? I'm just like, ready? Here's my little light. Laser, baby. It's like, ain't no nothing putting this light out. This ain't no little light. Who told you you had a little light? It's a stinking song you sang in Sunday school that lied to you. There's so many lies that have been in the church. Please understand, I love the church, but you're not a little light. You have the power that raised Christ from the dead sitting inside of you. We can't have our outside circumstances dictating how we feel on the inside anymore. We've got to take what's on the inside of us and change our outside sources. Got to. And love is a thing that actually, I got to settle down. I am sweating sitting here. Do you see? No, I'm glistening. I'm just glistening. That's all that. I'm just glistening. So here's this crazy guy by the name of Paul. He writes this book, one of the books in the Bible. It's to the people of Galatia, called Galatians. Almiricians. We're going to write a book to Almira, to Almiricians. I love the fact that Paul wrote this because Paul was a knucklehead who thought he was brilliant. Paul was a Pharisee amongst Pharisees, knew the Old Testament, memorized the whole deal, but yet when Christ showed up, didn't recognize him. Can I tell you something? Stop having your nose in the book and start living what you're reading in the book. Start seeing the way the book helps. Listen, you get stuck here, you miss what's going on here. You go here, 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 here. You take and you start living everything that you're reading out of that word. And I want to tell you something. If you just learn one verse and you live one verse, you're doing well. Don't just read over it. Be it. That makes sense? You're going to find out why in just a minute. Thanks, man. What am I gonna do? It's brand new, never been used. I was gonna blow my nose, but I'm not going to. What do you think? Give me my Harley, I'm ready to go. So, thanks, man. I feel like one of the guys now. Galatians 5. There were these people called Judaizers. Say that with me, Judaizers. Doesn't it just feel good to say Judaizer? I'm a Judaizer. No. They were Jewish Christians. They were Christians. They were Christians. Got that? But they were Jewish Christians. And they felt like, well, Jesus was a Jew, and he was a Jew first, so you ought to be one too. So Jewish Christians who believe that Gentiles, that's us, who aren't Jewish, unless you're Jewish, must convert to Judaism in order to move to join the Jesus movement that was going on. Can I tell you something? Let's stop doing that today. Let's stop having people come through the door and say, well, you got to become a part of this or a part of that before you can ever become a part of him. Mm-mm. There's no prerequisites to coming to him. You come as you are. Paul got serious about this, and he got so serious, and he got so mad. Dr. Cassetta sent me I didn't bring it out with me, but apoplectic. It's a good word. Bet you can't say it. Apoplectic. Do you know what it means? See that thing pop right there? It's like blood vessels. Dr. Cassetta sent this to me. It's like when blood vessels start popping in your head because you're so angry or so upset. Apostle Paul got apoplectic about this issue that we're going to talk about. He's like, ah! He's like, he had a Hulk moment, a code green. Ah! He got so upset. He got so upset because of what was going on in the church or in the Jewish culture with the Christians at this time. Because here's the deal. He said, listen, what you're doing is Jesus just came and started something and you're trying to dilute it. You're trying to denude it. You're trying to pollute it. I said all those things because they rhyme. So don't be diluted, don't be denuded, and don't be polluted because this message of Jesus is pure. It's powerful. It's ridiculous. It has the ability to change lives forever. And we've made it a church thing. We've made it a religious thing. He said, I want to make it a relationship thing. I want them to know the love of the Father. I want them to know my Son. I want the Holy Spirit to come and abide in them and to live in them and that we become one and that we have this amazing relationship that the whole world can't stand to look back and say, oh, what? Because what they see, because of what they hear, because of what they feel when they're around his bride, when they're around his sons and daughters who look just like him. And by the way, Accelerant this year is all about this. We want to get sons and daughters who look just like their daddy. Because I believe that the Father deserves to be represented well in the earth, represented appropriately in the earth. And I'm going to tell you something, that this thing that we're going to learn today is exactly how he should look. And anything else other than the way that he looks is an inappropriate rendering. Anybody hear that? You're a fake if you're not looking like him. It's serious. There's only one way to look like him, and it's not judgment. It's not finding what's wrong with people. It's finding what's right. Yeah? Galatians 5:1, here we go. I've got 10 minutes to rock this. Oh, that was me rocking. It is for freedom. Say that with me. It is for freedom. Say that one more time. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. If you have any other version of Christianity that isn't free, it's the wrong version. This is the only thing he came for, was to set you free. If you're in any type of prison, if you're tormented, if you're feeling condemned, if you're feeling in bondage, not Christianity. It's not. It's not Jesus. It's not Christ-like. He came for this purpose. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. He died on the cross. He took all of your punishment. He took all of the anger and the frustration of God on himself so you didn't have to have any of it. He took it all so that you could be free. The problem is we've lived in bondage for so long, we don't know how to live in freedom. It's not about all the wheels coming off and just doing whatever you want. That's not what freedom. You have the freedom to do everything that's right. You have the ability to actually do it. You didn't have the ability outside of Christ even to choose. But now you talk about this. You know, I see all these signs. God is pro-life. God is pro-life. That's true. Now hear this right. God is pro-choice. Not in that context. He wants you to be able to choose this day. Who are you going to serve? You're not under a bondage. You're not under slavery. You're not under, listen, do not burden yourselves again under a yoke of slavery. Don't go there again. I've set you free from that law that wanted to kill you. The letter of the law is designed to kill you. Do you understand that? So don't go back to it. It was the spirit of this letter. It brings life to you. Why do you want to be living in death when you can live in life? But we put ourselves, we put our families, we put our churches, we put our culture, we put people under such a yoke of bondage with criticism and being critical and being judged. Why not just let's step up to a higher level and say, you know what? Let me teach you how to live now in freedom. You know how many people come out of prison and don't know how to live free? That's why so many of them have to go back to prison because they never learned how to assimilate to freedom. That's what's happened to the church. We've stepped into freedom. We feel the weight coming off. And all of a sudden, the church wants to put the weight back on us because we feel safer in prison than we do free. That's my wife going, woo, woo, woo. She likes me. Galatians 5:2. Says, mark my words, exclamation point. I, Paul, tell you that if you let yourselves be circumcised. Now, can I tell you something? Paul was a Jew. He was circumcised. He's not against being circumcised. All the early Christians, they were Jews. They were all circumcised. A lot of you in here are circumcised. Let's just raise your hand if you're certain. No, just kidding. Just kidding. Oh, somebody edit that out, please. But it says, listen, he's not talking about the physical act. Yee-haw. He's not talking about that. He said, Christ will be of no value to you at all if you go down that road of being circumcised. You start taking in some of that old stuff. You start trying to meet the old requirements. Christ has no value. Why? Because Christ came to set you free. It goes on. Again, I declare to every man who lets himself be circumcised that he is obligated to obey the whole law. Hey, buddy. And hey, budette. Buddy, whatever. You know who you are, guys and girls. Here's the deal. If you try to keep one part of the law, you're obligated to take the whole thing on. And I'm going to tell you right now, you can't do it. Unless you're going to practice 630-some laws every single day, you don't want one of them. And you're not meant to have one of them. Stay with me. You are trying to be justified by the law. You who are trying to be justified by the law have been alienated from Christ. You want to be circumcised? You alienate yourself from Christ. That's what Paul's saying. Remember the face? He's apoplectic, right? Paul is such a gentleman. He was type A personality all the way, bro. Alienated from Christ. You have what? Fallen away from what? Grace. You know what grace did? Remember the law we taught, 630-something? You know what grace did? Grace took the law and blew it out of proportion so much that you couldn't do it without grace. Grace actually raises the standard. What do you mean by that, Pastor Scott? Let me tell you what I mean. Here, ready? The law said this, thou shalt not murder. Grace says this, Jesus said this. You've heard it said, don't kill somebody. I tell you, if you hate somebody in your heart, you've already murdered him. Anybody ever, uh-oh. How about this? Don't commit adultery, the law said. What did Jesus say? If you even think about a woman, you've already committed adultery in your heart. Uh-oh. If you look upon a woman, uh-oh. You guys should try that with me. Ready? One, two, three. Uh-oh. Right? If you can't hate your father, water, thanks. If you don't hate your father and mother, your sons and your daughters, you can't be my disciple. I've been able to do one or two of those at a time, but who can do that? Can I tell you what grace did? Grace said this. Hey, listen, I'm going to raise the standard so high that even the elite can't do it. But here's who can do it. What was impossible for man is absolutely possible with God. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. What can come against me? If God is for me, who can come against me? What can come against me? Cancer? No. Sickness? No. Disease? No. Failures, financial collapses, political things. No, it doesn't matter. Why? We live in an environment that is conducive to life because we live in a, if you would, a greenhouse effect of his spirit where we're carriers of his presence and we've set with a thermostat an environment all around us that is impermeable to the world's disease. You just didn't hear that. But that's what we have. That's the resource that we have. Who can be against you? Who can be against you? Well, lots of stuff, Pastor Scott, not if God is for you. See, we haven't really believed that God is for us because we're still trying to self-preservation our lives. Got to look out for me. Got to look out for number one. Got to take care of this. Got to take care of that. Got to make this plan. Make that. No, no, no. Unless you are willing to lose your life, you never really find life. You're so consumed with trying to protect everything that you're, and you're losing the fact of the main thing, living for what's really important, living for a life that's worth living, living for something greater than yourself because you're so consumed in something. How many want to go to the grave and all you've ever lived for was yourself? I think you're worth living for a lot more than that. I think there's things to live for a lot more than that. I don't want to sit there. You and I are designed for something greater than just ourselves. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision has any value. The only thing that counts, say this with me. The only thing that counts, say this with me. The only thing that counts, say this with me. The only thing that counts. What? We got this big book called the Bible, and the only thing that counts. We've got all these laws and rituals, and the only thing that counts, we've heard all these podcasts, and the only thing that counts, we've heard all these sermons, and the only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love. The only thing that counts. The only thing that counts. Only thing that counts. It's not about whether I have wine in church or not. It's not a matter of whether I memorize this many scriptures or not. You're saying that, like I used to come to church and I'd come right into church and I'd get right down here and I would always be worried. My God, am I all right with you? Am I okay? Am I doing okay? Am I making the mark? Am I qualified? Have I made, you know, are you for me? You know, can I tell you something? When somebody dies for you, they're for you. They're stinking for you. You don't have to ask that question again. He is for you. He adores you. He loves you. He died for you and he'd die again for you. Why are we asking that question? I'll tell you why, because the enemy's lying to us, saying we're not that valuable. See, you know the value of somebody when the price that is paid is of high value, and there was no greater price, there was not a higher price that could have been paid for any of us than the price that he did. Father gave his only begotten son so that we could have life. Wow. But you know what? Somehow, guys, we all started out that way. I don't know anybody who signed up for a bunch of rules. When I accepted Jesus, I didn't sign up and say, oh, give me a bunch of rules. I want the rule book. Give me the rule book. I'm about the rules. You know what I signed up for? I want to know you better. So my question today is not about the rules, not about the... We got a new standard to live by. And it's not a rule book. It's called love. You can say that the law says that you... speed limit is 55. I think we got to stop asking what's legal in the church and start asking what's love demanding of me. Pastor Scott, if I talk to him about that, you know, I just don't know. I'm going to be uncomfortable and we're just not like that. And we don't have really a great relationship. But what's love demanding of you? Oh, Pastor Scott, I got this thing. She's really nice. And you know, it's consensual. And you know, she likes me and I like her and stuff, you know? Yeah. But buddy, what's love asking you to do? Pastor Scott, I'm struggling, you know. My husband, you know, it's just, I should talk in a higher voice. Pastor Scott, I'm struggling with my husband. It's like, I feel like God's telling me just to let him go and move in his arm. Maybe I'd ask what love's asking of you. See, the love that he has, he demonstrated. He said, listen, no greater love does a man or woman have than they lay their lives down for their friend. Pastor Scott, nothing's working. I've tried everything. I've tried counseling. That's good. Counseling's good. You know, I've been reading my Bible more. I've been praying more. You know, that's good. Those things are all good. But only love never fails. How about just deciding what would happen to the world, guys? What would happen to our families? What would happen to our kids? What would happen to people at work if all that we did was this one thing? Only one thing counts, is that I'm going to love people and my faith is going to be expressed how I love them. Not how I judge them, not how I bash them, not how I find what's wrong in them. But see, love overlooks a multitude of sins. Love doesn't remember wrongs. Love doesn't seek its own way. Love, it never fails. It doesn't get exhausted. It doesn't get tired. Love has the ability to keep going. But here's the problem. When you start demonstrating unconditional love, people aren't going to believe you at the beginning. So love has to be perpetual. It has to be continual. You can't give up on loving, because that will be the thing that they said, see, told you it wasn't for real. Love has no end. So if you do decide, now listen, keeping 630 some laws, it's hard. But I'm gonna tell you something that's much harder and will need the grace of God, is to learn to just love people, because they're people. They deserve to be loved. Isn't it good to be loved and then be able to love? I love this guy right here. You guys don't know. I just love this guy right here. The first time I met him, I go, I love this guy. And I was like, how can you don't know me? How can you love me? You don't know. First time I met Travis. Of course, you know, his family wrecked me. That was easy. Matt, I'm still working on loving you, bro. He knows that's not true, man. You see, here's the deal. You can't love people appropriately unless you first are loved appropriately. But he loved me so well, and I let him. Like, I went, oh, here you go, love me. And when he did, I got something to give to people. I got something to love people with. But the enemy wants to rob us of the very thing that brings life to all of us. And it will be the thing that changes our families. It changes our school culture. It changes government. It changes churches. It will change all your relationships. Everything that gets touched with love gets better. Everything. So even if you never believe in this Jesus the way that I do, maybe you don't take him as that, would you at least do this today? Would you be willing to say, hey, Pastor Scott, I'm going to let him love me. I'm going to let him at least teach me what it looks like to be loved. Because I'm going to tell you, here's the danger, though, of that. When you let him into that capacity, he doesn't come trial size. He will overwhelm you with his goodness. He will overwhelm you with his kindness. He will overwhelm you with his love. It won't be a church experience. It won't be an issuing of words. It won't be a thing that you declare, that recite after me. It's not that. It's just like this. Just like this. Hey, I'd like to spend some time with you. If that's you today, let's just stand together and let's just do it. Can we just do that? Let's just do it one last time in worship. And then Curtis is going to come and dismiss you, give us some final instructions. Man, I'm so glad that you guys were here. We're going to go after this week. We're going to get ruckus and accelerant this week. We're going to get ruckus. We got a dance party happening on Friday night at 10 o'clock with my boy Michael Kellogg over here. It's going to get stupid. We're going to be, I don't know, all that stuff. But come and have life this week. Find love. Find hope. Yeah, I know. It's stupid, right? I know. Why does an old fat guy dance like, I don't know. It's just. Live again, though, you know? Be free to live again. That's my request today. Let's worship him one more time. I love you guys. Thanks for being here today.